big as it is in life, okay? The center one is 1x, it's exactly the same here as it is there, right? And what do you pay for when you buy a macro lens? What do you pay for when you get a macro capability? You pay for this. Some of you have macro capabilities. If you read the fine print in your camera manual, it'll say 1/5 life size or 1/4. That's it, which is fine. But that you have to know what it'll do. Don't try to make it do something it won't do. Here's one. See this one? It's twice as big as that. That's 2x. That's twice as large. Okay. Now you have to beware that each one of these different magnifications carry something you have to do to get the image. It's not the same. Okay, it's not the same. But. All right, what are the problems that you're gonna face through macro photography? You can probably guess them. One, depth of field. Okay, remember, the shorter the focal length lens, the more depth of field you get per f-stop, you remember that? The longer the focus, the less depth of field. All right, the same rule applies. The closer you get to a subject, the less depth of field you get for each f-stop. Okay? It's called the inverse square law kind of thing, you know. But just remember, the closer you get to the subject, depth of field becomes an issue that you have to deal with. And you also got to remember, you know, these are small aperture, these are all in focus. Big aperture, only the center is in focus, right? That's very important in macro photography, very, very important. If your macro photography is not sharp, it's done. I mean, there's nothing you can do to fix it. Okay, subject camera motion. If you've got a holding a lens, you're shooting out there, you know, the horizon's not going. It's just sitting there, right? If you're trying to photograph an ant that's 3 inches away, oh, there's all kinds of crap happening. The ant's moving, he's vibrating, you're wriggling, you know, kind of thing. You ever tried to pick up a hammer and hit a nail? You ever tried to pick up a teeny little hammer and hit a teeny little pin? All this motion shows up, right? It all magnifies. Well, that happens when you get close to a subject. All right. Okay. Oh, Tiger went backwards here. Closer to the subject, you need more light. I mean, which means you have to use a slower shutter speed, which means it magnifies your vibration. God, you hate that, right? The inverse square law, where every time you have the distance to a subject, you need 4 times as much light to get the same exposure. Don't worry about why, it's just you do. As you get closer to the subject, you need more light to expose it. Because if you're this far away from the subject, you need X amount of light. If you're that far away, you need 4X amount of light. You gotta remember that which means you're gonna need more shutter speed, you're gonna have to bump up the ISO, you know, you have to do something to compensate for it. Getting enough magnification. I see a lot of photos over here of images that, man, I wish you were closer. And why aren't you closer? Either the camera didn't allow you to get any closer, or you're afraid. You know, afraid to get too close. You know, it's intimidating. Try taking a picture of a jumping spider's face. Crap. What's the thing looking back at you? You know? All right. So, getting enough magnification, getting enough light, it's the same problems that you face every time you take a picture. The problem is that they're all literally magnified because we're so close to the subject. which means don't not try it. Just remember that they're there. And working distance. Okay. What's that mean? It means, okay, here's the butterfly. Here's my macro lens. If I want to get a life-size picture of the butterfly, I have to be this close to it. What's the butterfly going to do when you get that close to it? It's going to fly away. If it's a flower, it doesn't care. But if it's something, all right. So what is the function of working distance? It's focal length of the lens. Okay. How long? Talk about that in a minute. I'm talking about right now. All right. Here's a macro lens. This is a 50 millimeter macro lens. Or 60 millimeter macro lens. That's its focal length. To get this image of life size, this is your working distance. The distance between the front of the lens and above. Okay? Sometimes it's 3 inches, sometimes it's 6 inches. All right, here's a 100 millimeter macro lens. To get the same size image, I'm further away. The working distance is bigger. Is that good or bad? It's good, because you don't have to get so close to something. Okay? That's why it's good. That's why when you buy a macro lens, it'll say 50 millimeter lens, 100 millimeter lens, 180 millimeter lens, and guess what? The longer the lens, macro lens get, the more expensive they get, because you pay for everything. You're paying for working distance. Okay? So, how do you get close to your subject? All right. The simplest and the cheapest way, and you can all do this, is there's a filter called a close-up filter, which looks like this. It looks just like a filter. It's clear, but it's not flat. This means you put that in front of your lens and allows you to get closer, okay? Right. Plus one, why do you get so close? Plus two, plus three. That's the first step. When I first started photography, these were like $10 a piece. I have no idea what they cost now.
Huh? It could have went about $100.
Yeah, well.
Cheap by about 40. Cheaper one, 30, 40.
But you put that in front of your lens, it allows you to physically approach it. It's no longer a regular lens, it's a macro lens. And if you notice, some of your point and shoot will have those that are available for point and shoots. You know, this is the cheapest way to do that. All right. Another way to do it, if you have a 35 millimeter camera that has detachable lenses, if you don't, you can't do this. Okay. But if you do, you can. You can buy. Called extension tubes. What the heck is that? Yeah. Here's an extension tube. These are about the same price as a close-up filter, because there's no, is there any glass in there? No, there's no glass in there. There's no lens. Lenses are what cost money. This is simply a mechanical device that you put between the camera and any lens, doesn't matter, any lens. Okay, so I've taken this 400 millimeter lens, expensive lens, it is no longer a 400 millimeter lens. What is it? It's a 400 millimeter macro lens. Simply because you've taken all these elements and you've moved them away sensor so that it's projecting on a bigger image on the same size, so it's physically magnifying the subject. So I can get a life-size image from right here. Whereas a 50 millimeter lens, I'd be right here. Okay? So this is also a way to turn your equipment into macro equipment if you have something that has detachable lenses. If you don't, then don't worry about it. Okay. Now, is there anything magic about those tubes? No. If you buy a tube that's like $12, it's gonna be just a tube. You know, your camera and your lens are connected. You'll have automatic focus and all. If you buy a cheap tube, none of that works. You might as well get a toilet paper tube, paint it black, and duct tape it to it, because it's the same thing. Right? All right. So don't be taken in by all this stuff in photo magazines, you know. Well, that's another way to get closer to the subject. Here they are, they come in 5mm, 15mm, 25mm. The thicker the tube, the higher the magnification, right? That was a 15 I had, Sue had the 25. I wouldn't even bother with a 5, why bother? But you can also put them all together, you know. It's an additive effect. You simply move, every time you move the lens away, the elements, you get a bigger image. And that's cheap. That's about the same size, price as the screw-in filter, but you get better quality because you're using the lens optics, not some piece of glass that's in front of the lens, okay? And then you can, the high end, of course, is to have macro lenses, okay? Or have a macro capability on your camera. Come in like 50 to 100 millimeter, 100 to 200 millimeter. They either come in half life size or life size, simply means that shows you how much magnification they get. So when you buy a lens, it'll say 50 millimeter macro lens, 1/2 life size. What does that mean? It means you buy the camera and the lens will give you half life size. If you want to get life size, you have to buy the extension tube to go behind it. Or else if you buy one that goes 1:1, then you don't have to do that. What's the difference between the 50 millimeter and 100 millimeter? Working distance. Okay, so you pay for working distance and you pay for magnification. That's what you pay for. That's why these lenses are different prices. And then there's something else called a super macro lens. What the hell is that? Nobody has those. Okay, nobody has. It's a lens that goes from 1x up to 5x. Boy, now there's a range that you never see. Okay? Who has one of these? I have one. Okay. And why do you have one? Because I like to do things that are weird. I'll talk about that in a minute. Mm-hmm. All right. Then lighting. Okay. You have to have light, right? This is still photography. Natural light. That's the best, right? That's the best. That's what's natural. That's what's lighting the world. Preferably if you have the option. Remember I said most light on Earth is less than 5 millimeters long? Every time you get half the distance, you need 4 times as much light? Pretty soon, what? There's none left. Okay, if you want to photograph an ant running across a log at dusk, there's not enough light, no matter what you do, okay? So it's preferable. Your options are limited. Not enough light. So you need supplementary light. Where flash comes in, okay? A little bit. Greatly increase your opportunities, because the other thing is about, remember, 95% of all of those organisms, less than 5 millimeters long, 60% of all animals on Earth are nocturnal. Oh, crap. What are we going to do about that? There's some big flood, you know, I see Kelvin walking around with a man with a big floodlight for Kelvin. You know? No. This requires specialized equipment. Everything does, I'm sorry. Let's look at natural light. Works great for plants on calm days. Works great for plants on sunny, not calm days. Works great for sedentary subjects. Works great for non-sedentary subjects if you know what to do. When something is moving, you know, you have a different layer of variables that you have to deal with. And I guarantee it's easier to photograph a deer running across a lake with a telephoto than it is a butterfly flying through the air across your viewfinder. Because everything is so close. It's difficult. All right. Challenging. It is challenging. And it's something that we can all learn to do, but it takes practice and experience. And whatever. And using macro photography with natural subjects requires working distance and often a tripod, so that it doesn't subject to the flight. All right, what does it look like? It can be beautiful, okay? Mating beetles on a cactus at dusk in the Sonora Desert, you know? There's a moth sitting on a prairie on a cloudy day at dusk, mating swallowtails. Could you plant? You name it. We notice the techniques are all the same that you use for every other kind of photography, but you still apply them to macro photography, you know, getting parallel to plane, background, all that sort of stuff still applies. Okay, so let's look at electronic flash for a minute. You always say, well, if it's flash, you can't, you know, it always looks really harsh and crappy. No, it doesn't. Okay. You see all these butterfly pictures on here? Do those all look harsh and crappy? 95% of them are taken with electronic flash, okay? Right? You just simply have to know what to do. Provide its own unique look, it can mimic the sun, works great on small subjects, because the flash gives you lots of light, all right? Lots of